honored that you all risk your life despite Corona coming here. Today I'm going to tell you something about our passenger forecasting model that we built at KLM. We called it Pythia, which is named after the wisdom that is inside the Oracle of Delphi. And it's sort of similar to Python, so that's why we thought it was a suitable name. And I'm going to focus on the multitask aspect of our model. So let's dive right in. First, let me introduce the team, because I did not do this all by myself. One of them is here. This is Giovanni. Then we have Anand. He's kind of our neural network guru. Tom and Kai, unfortunately, left the team already. And we have Dan, who's our product owner. So let's get started with some context. Why are we actually doing this? Ah, yeah, sorry. Dan is the successor of Robin, who is right there in the back. So some context. Well, if you book a ticket, then, well, you book, you check in, you get on your flight. But for KLM, actually, operating a flight starts much longer before that. So at some point, we need to decide where do we fly, when do we fly. Then planning starts, which crew flies which flight. Also on the ground, who does check-in. And for most of these planning processes, passenger forecasts are needed because it's dependent on the number of passengers that we need to process. So passengers in the airline world are called PAX. Hence, this says PAX forecast over there. And then at some point, well, the flight departs and hopefully everything went well. So what we are going to do is predict the number of passengers that will board a flight. So we have a timeline. At some point, the flight is going to depart. And before that, we need to do some planning. So relative to departure, we have several moments that we want to have a prediction, depending on the type of planning that we are doing. And these are our forecast horizons, all relative to departure. And we are not just predicting passengers just like that, because there are different types of passengers. And also with a passenger usually comes baggage. And that's also interesting. Now, we have many different users for our model. And they all want different things. So one distinction that we make is long-term versus short-term. So we now have a model that goes from 4.5 months before the flight up until 22 minutes before the flight, which is when catering can last make changes. And there's even stakeholders that would like models starting even earlier, like up to a year before the flight. But we're not there yet. Then, as I mentioned, we have passenger versus baggage. We have airport versus airplane. So some people need forecasts on a flight level. But some people also need a forecast for the whole airport, how many people will be in the departure hall, for example. And lastly, we have KLM, of course, which is the airline I'm working for, so we make predictions for them. But then KLM also offers a lot of services to other airlines. So for example, baggage handling at the airport is largely done by KLM. So we need to make predictions also for partner airlines. Yes, so we have a unique identifier for certain flights, so that doesn't matter. So there are several PAX forecasting systems in place at several departments, but they are not unified. So this is the main reason for us to want to replace them. Basically, these models can go from an actual machine learning model to someone with a lot of experience who thinks it will be approximately such and such. So we want to unify these. Secondly, not all of them are accurate. Not all of them are complete. So they don't offer what the users actually need. And lastly, not all of these systems are supported anymore. So for example, some of them are developing a second version. But that's only for Air France. So we need some way to replace this also on the KLM side. So a quick overview of the use cases. For passengers, we have three main groups. It's customs and security for, well, waiting times and how many security lanes do we open. We have check-in, how many check-in desks do we open and when. And we have catering, because they need to know the number of business and economy meals to put on board. Then for baggage, we have another few departments. So that's baggage handling, which makes sure that your baggage goes where it should go. We have cargo, and we have load control, which sort of balances passenger baggage with cargo. So our three main challenges for this project. First of all, it lies in the fact that we have so many users, and we need to make predictions for all of them. And they need to be suitable for these users, else they won't use them. Second one is to maintain some form of consistency between all these predictions. Because, for example, we predict economy passengers and business passengers. Well, if you add them up, you get the total number. But then if we also predict local and transfer passengers, that should also add up to sort of the same number at least. So that's the reason why we thought of the multitask approach. And then lastly, we need to exceed everyone's benchmarks to make sure that they will actually start using the new model and we can get rid of all these separate systems in the different departments. Enter multitask learning. So for humans, multitasking is not usually a good idea. For machine learning models, there are some indications that it might actually be a good idea. So let's have a look. We have two ways of looking at these problems. So we can model everything separately. I have three of the categories here, economy class, business class, and bags. So we could make a model for each one of them and have each one of them output one number. Or we could create one model that outputs three numbers at the same time, multitask learning. So just a quick comparison. When you think of development effort, it is much more simple to train a single task model because you don't need to think about how do these outputs relate to each other, and you can go about, well, your work as you normally would. Then for hardware requirements, well, these models, if you build a single task model, they are usually a bit smaller, so you don't need a very beefy computer to run these models. And it's relatively easy to add tasks because you can just train a new model and you don't need to take into account the effect on the other outputs. On the other hand, well, if you build single models for everything, they are not consistent. They are more difficult to maintain because if there is a change, then you need to make that change in every model. More models also means more chances that one of them is going to break down. Retraining also becomes a pain. Then there's tuning and training time. So if you're tuning your hyperparameters, then if you have just one model for everything, you need to do one round of hyperparameter tuning. If you have separate models for everything, you need to do as many rounds as you have targets. And then lastly, I have performance with some question marks. In theory, there are indications that this would work. In practice, I will talk about that a bit more later. Let's have a look at the theory, though. So why should it work? This is from a blog post by Sebastian Ruder. He mentions four reasons. So the first one, why multitask learning might be beneficial, is that it's sort of an automatic form of regularization. Because if you have multiple outputs, then you have multiple losses. And that means that the model cannot really overfit to one loss because it has to make sure it also does well on the other losses. Then there's, well, eavesdropping, he calls it. So if you have features that relate strongly to a certain output, but not so much to another, then the task that is not so related can still benefit from the patterns that are learned relation to the other output. Models are supposed to learn faster which features are relevant because, well, if features are relevant for multiple targets, then they are probably actually important. And if they're just important for one target, then perhaps it's noise. And lastly, we may benefit from task similarity. So if you have multiple outputs that are very similar, then it will be easier for the model to pick up those relations. Now, one way to do multitask learning is with neural networks. It's actually quite intuitive. So this is a schematic overview of a normal neural network. We have some inputs. Then you have the core of your network, which is, well, dense layers, embeddings, whatever you like. And then we have an output. And if we extend that, then basically we can just add as many outputs as we want. So output A and output B in this case. And we can also add separate layers before these outputs. So we can have a share part first and then split it up and have something specific to the outputs. Now, one thing that we definitely learned doing this project is that multitask learning comes with decisions, very many of them. So I will take you through some of them that you need to consider. So layer sharing at first. This is a picture that we just saw. Well, basically, we need to determine how many layers are in the core, how many layers are in the towers, and what kind of layers are they. Then there's task grouping. What this means is that if we have outputs that are maybe more similar to each other than to some of the other targets, then maybe we can combine those and give them a tower together. That's an option. We need to think about feature sharing, because maybe you have some features that are not actually relevant for all of your outputs. So you can add them later, and you can have a part of your inputs going into all of your network, and then a part that only joins, in this case, for output B. Then we need to choose our losses, because multiple outputs means multiple losses. And we can kind of mix and match as we want. So for example, we can choose to give two of them an MAE loss and another one the MSE. We need to come up with some form of loss weighting, because if we want to use regular optimizers for these neural networks, then, well, they need to calculate the gradient with respect to one loss. So the easiest way is to come up with some linear combination of your separate losses. So that could look something like this. If we think output B is very important, we give it 60% of the weight and divide it over the others. However, there's also different optimizers. So loss weighting, you do it, well, when you want to use the standard optimizers. But perhaps you want to instead use an optimizer that directly tries to find a Pareto optimal solution where you cannot improve on one target without reducing another. That's also an option. We can think of auxiliary tasks. So what this means is we add an output to the model that we're not actually interested in, but we think it will help the model learn certain patterns, and it will sort of guide the model towards learning parameters that are useful for the targets that we are interested in. And then lastly, there's training strategy. So we can choose to fix some parameters and train others. Maybe train a certain part of the network first and then other parts only later. So one example of this would be, for example, transfer learning. And, well, we considered a lot of them, but in this presentation, well, those five are gonna come back in a bit more detail. So let's go into the modeling. What goes into the model? Well, you may think people buy a ticket, so we know who's going to fly, right? Book passengers equals border passengers? Not exactly. So when it's long before a flight, of course we have limited bookings. And also some of the features may not be available, some of the other features that we use. Because as we get closer to departure, we get more information about the flight. But even then, There might be last minute bookings. There might be upgrades from economy class to business. There might be people not showing up. There might be aircraft changes, which means that all of a sudden we have more capacity or less than we expected. So all of that needs to be taken into account. So what do we have as the main features? It's bookings, the aircraft, so that relates to capacity. It's the location, so what airport is it flying from and to. Also we have which country is it going to. And then we have daytime features, like which day of the week is it. And these are the basic inputs to the model. Then we have a lot of forecast horizons. And well, you can deal with them, I think, in two main ways. You can build separate models for each forecast horizon, or you can make your horizon one of your features. And this is what we did. So we have the hours to departure as a feature. Then for the outputs, we have cabin class, so the number of economy class passengers and the number of business class passengers for a flight. Then this one is a bit more complicated. So there's six of them. Basically, this is about local and transfer passengers. So if we look at the top left, these are people that are going on a departing flight and they're starting locally. So they're starting in the same airport that that flight is leaving from. Then if you move one down, that would be people coming from a Europe flight and transferring onto whatever flight we're predicting for. And the last one, ICA, stands for intercontinental. So that would be people coming from an intercontinental flight and going onto the flight that we are predicting for. And then we have the same for what we call arriving. So how many people on the flight are at their destination when the flight lands? How many people on that flight will transfer onto a Europe flight, and how many people will transfer onto an ICA flight. And lastly, baggage, which is the number of bags as well as the weight. And all of this over the hours to departure. We have 59 query moments. So it starts approximately 4.5 months before the flight. And then as we get closer, we have more and more frequent updates. Until the day of departure, it's at least every hour. So a bit about loss weighting. This is our loss function. So it's a sum over 10 because we have 10 different outputs. So we have 10 separate losses. And then lambda is the loss for one output. And W is the weight that we assign to that output. So lambda, in this case, we chose to use the MAE for everything because it makes sense from a business perspective. And the weights, they're a bit more complicated. They need to do two things. One, not all our targets are on the same scale, because you can imagine business class passengers, there will be a few, whereas baggage weight, it's about thousands of kilos. So we need to scale them. And second, we need to take into account the relative importance of these targets. So this is exactly what we based our loss weights on. We came up with a scale that reflects roughly the scale of these targets on average. And we assigned relative importances. And then combining those, we came up with losses. So this is, semi-data driven, but still very much arbitrary. So one of the points that we want to improve on in the future is making this more data driven rather than an objective, rather than our own idea of what it should be. So then the model architecture. It's a neural network. We have 21 numerical inputs. 5 categorical inputs, which go into embedding layers. And then we added some indicators when certain variables are missing. Because, for example, bookings are extremely important. And if they're not missing, then the model really messes up. So the numerical features go into a dense layer together. So this is the core part, where the embeddings and the numerics get concatenated. And then after that, we get a specialized part for each output. So there's one for economy, then for business, local departing, and all the other losses that you saw. You will see for economy and business, well, it's not so clear, but there's a lambda layer there, which is a custom Keras layer, which is used to do post-processing. Because for economy and business, we know exactly how much capacity we have on board. So we make sure that our prediction does not go over that if we are close to departure. Because if we're far away from departure, then we know that the aircraft might still change. So capping it does not make a whole lot of sense. But once we're close to departure, we start to cap it. Now, how did we get to this architecture? These are some of the considerations that we made. They're from the list, basically, that I mentioned before. So for layer sharing, looking at the performance of single task models, we figured that we should give some room for specialization. And I'll get back to the performance of single task later, but trust me on this one now for now. So that would be these dense layers of 128 units. That's what we're talking about now. So that's what we tried. That worked. Hence these layers on the previous slide. We tried a bunch of different configurations, more units, more specialized layers, but this was what came out best. Then for task grouping, we have quite a business-driven case for grouping tasks because, well, economy and business are kind of counterparts. The arriving levels are kind of counterparts. Baggage targets are similar. So that would make a lot of sense. We looked at this a bit more. So by partial dependency plots, what is a partial dependency plot? Basically shows if we vary the value of one of your features, that would be on the x-axis, then what happens to your prediction on average? In this case, you can look at the red line, which is the average over all samples. And I've shown them here for the bookings for people transferring from an ICA flight. And they are for the targets, local, transferring from Europe and transferring from ICA. So what we can see here very nicely is that if the bookings for this category go up on the x-axis, then also our predictions for that go up. Now the nice thing about this is that these three categories are mutually exclusive. Like either you are a local passenger, or you transfer from Ur, or you transfer from an intercontinental flight. There's no other option, right? You cannot be both. So what we see is that that one goes up if the bookings go up, but then that also means that these passengers cannot be local or transfer. So we see that these predictions go down as the ICA bookings go up. So that kind of confirmed this way of thinking about grouping the outputs, because we can see that the model has indeed learned that they are together in some sense. So we tried making groups of blocks at the end of the network, and that didn't work. So logic is not always what the network finds. And then a last one for feature sharing. We know from experience that there are certain flights, for example, to Paramaribo in Suriname or to Accra in Ghana, where people bring a lot of baggage. So that could be 3 to 4 bags on average per person, because people probably fly home and they bring goodies and gifts, whatever. So when we have some categorical inputs, such as the arrival airport, then we might expect that maybe the arrival airport has a different effect on baggage than on passengers, because in terms of passengers, these flights are pretty ordinary. So what we try to do is see what happens if we have separate embeddings for the passengers as opposed to the baggage output. That also didn't work. So where are we at? We covered predicting for all the users. This model maintains consistency. So now let's look at how we do against some of the benchmarks that we had. The first one, so this is the cabin class, economy and business. We compare this to a model called MOPS, Meals on Board System, because economy and business is mostly used by catering. And we see that we do slightly worse. So this is the difference in percentage. This is second decimal point, though, if we look at the MAE. So it's not that bad. Then if we look at the arriving and departing levels, just showing them together because our benchmark is the same one. It's called Petra. Well, the picture looks a lot better. We do up to 50% better than the old model. And for baggage, it's much better. And this also kind of makes sense because MOPS is the only one that is an actual machine learning model, namely gradient boosting. And the other ones are, smart models, but not machine learning, I guess. So for the comparison to single task models, all the way in the beginning of the project, we did some comparisons, of course, to see, which way should we go. And the differences were quite small. So for all the benefits that multitask models have, like maintenance and consistency, we decided to pursue that route. So now we reran these analyses from the beginning, and actually we were a bit shocked last week. So hold on. What we have here is multitask versus single task. Again, percentage differences. You can see that single task definitely tends to perform better on all these levels. And most of them we are not really worried about, so the arriving, departing, and baggage, because, we already really strongly beat their current benchmarks. For economy and business, though, it's, a different story, because these percentage gains could actually make the difference between comfortably beating what they are now using and, kind of not. And especially business, because for catering, business meals are extremely important, because you can imagine if you buy a business class ticket and they have to sell you, we don't have enough business meals and you cannot get one, then you'd probably be pretty pissed. So this is an interesting finding that we definitely need to look into more. It also kind of spiked my curiosity about why this is. So I ran another experiment where instead of having the multitask model with 10 targets, I ran it with just 3 of them. And that would be the arriving targets. So if we compare that to the single task, then we see that it becomes quite a bit better than the multitask model with everything in it. And even on the transfer Europe, it's better than single task. So there is some truth to this theory that multitask models can bring gains, but it seems like you have to make sure that your tasks are indeed very similar. And maybe you should not have too many. So then a final comparison in terms of training time. So what we have here, the first one is multitask with everything, 10 targets. The second one is multitask on the arriving levels only. Then you have single task, if we add up the training time of all these separate models. And the last one is single task, the average for training one single task model. And what you can see is that the single task model, its training time is a factor 5 of the multitask model. So that's a lot. Then what we can also see, if you look at the first one and the second one, the first one has 7 more outputs, but it takes like this much longer to train. So training time of a multitask model doesn't really scale linearly with your number of targets. So that is beneficial because it means you can add targets relatively easily without increasing your training time too much. Also, running these experiments, I noticed that training effort of a multitask model is much lower because you don't need to keep track of all these separate models. You don't need to keep track of all the separate hyperparameters. So that's another benefit. So for some conclusions, we have a few open problems. First of all, and strongly, is to investigate this difference to the single task model, especially for business, because it's clear that there's room for improvement. The second one, I already mentioned in a bit more detail. We want to be smarter about our loss weighting and sort of get rid of this arbitrary component in our model. And the last one, which will be especially interesting once we go live, is that the model is kind of closed for extension. Because if you want to change one task to improve it, for example, then that almost automatically leads to changes in the other tasks as well. So if you make improvements for one output, then the others might get worse. And especially when you have a model live, we will have to see how we handle that, given that stakeholders are relying on a model. And if you make an update, they will not expect that their specific target that they are interested in might get worse. Some key takeaways then. If you ever find yourself in a situation where you have to predict multiple things at the same time, consider multitask learning. We've seen like it has its drawbacks and it has its benefits. Benefits being consistent output, maintenance, and training time and training effort. But the drawbacks being that, well, performance gain is not given. And you have a lot of things to consider. Then think of neural networks if you want to try multitask learning because it's very intuitive. And lastly, always benchmark your results against a specialist, a single task approach, because as we've seen, these performance gains are not always there, and you want to know how big your difference is and how much that matters to you to be able to make a good decision about what to do. Thank you. Any questions?
Yeah, I have a question because I think your multitask model looks really, really good. But I think, like in one of the last picture, performance picture you showed, like I think it was on average like 1% worse than if you have a single task model.
Yeah.
Or 1 or maybe 2%. But that's like percentage. But can you also express this in money? Like how much? How would the difference be? Like
yeah.
You can also like. Yeah, I don't know. Just keep maintain all the models because I can imagine there's a lot of money involved and 1% is quite a lot, right?
Yeah. Yeah, so this is, well, it's always a difficult question. You probably know that as well. When you ask stakeholders to express something in money. But yeah, this is definitely, I said we were a little bit shocked last week when we saw this because we do have to investigate indeed what this means. Well, for most of them, I think it would be all right. But like I said, for business, this indeed is a lot of money. So yeah.
Now we're talking about millions or yeah.
I don't know. I don't know if I also don't know if I'm allowed to say. if I knew.
You do know it.
Yeah?
So do I understand correctly that the order of modeling was first you tried the multi-task learning and then you looked into the single-task learning, or?
No, so all the way at the beginning of the project, we kind of started them simultaneously, and the differences were quite small. And then we decided to go with the multitask approach. And then in the meantime, well, we did not really consider the single task seriously anymore. So yeah, it started at the beginning and then it developed from there into multitask.
So what changed in between? Did you just spend more effort into hyperparameter tuning now, back then, or did the data change?
Yeah, it's difficult to say. The data, well, we did have updated data, quite a few changes. So we had a different target source back then, and we also have an updated data set. It's also our test set here was, I think, mostly December, which is also well, a bit of a peculiar month, but we don't have that much data, so we went with it anyway. So that might play a role, but who knows, yeah.
Can you say a few words about how big the dataset is?
Yeah, so it's nearly a year of data, and it's about 17 million rows, I think, of training data. But that's a bit skewed because that includes all the query moments. So you need to divide that by 60.
Let's say I have some models. What would be like a good number of models? When would you start with multitask learning? So you had like, is it 8 or 10 models?
Yeah.
Would you already do like this approach like with 2 models or 3, or do you have like any clue?
Yeah, I guess it kind of depends also on how difficult your problem is. So if you can get good performance with a relatively simple model. Like I think it's easier to maintain 10 linear regressions than 10 neural networks, for example. So that influences it. I think more than how many targets you have, it's important what kind of targets you have. So are they similar in some way? Which I think is also what we see in this subset multitask model. Like the arriving levels, it works quite well for those because they are so closely related. So I think that's more important than the actual number.
So for the arriving times, you say if you have 3 of them quite similar, then it's already worth it to have a multitask.
Yeah, I would say so. Well, you can see here it even does better on one of the targets. So it seems like there's some synergy here. But yeah.
Mm-hmm. Do you use your model for the next prediction to make it better? Like maybe some cases. I know you already mentioned that you're gonna do something about the weight, but like for the next prediction, are you gonna use the current model to improve so that it fits?
What do you mean with the next prediction?
So if for the next period, so when you want to. Predict the next.
Ah, I see. Well, yeah, so the model, like these decisions, the planning decisions, they are made continuously. Like every day there's people doing that work. So there's not a batch round of predictions. But we are now working on implementing it for, well, economy and business. With catering, we are now in the process of making the comparison to their old model and having them make the decision to switch because it's well better or well it has other advantages. For the others, so arriving and departing, for example, it is one big system that distributes this data to all the planners. And for that one, we are also working with them to get it implemented there and replace their previous source. So that's now our status, and I think it will take probably another quarter before it starts being used. Yeah. All right. If anyone has questions later, I'll be here for a bit.